Hi, welcome to the laundry rooms in Sheffield. We're sat in the Muse Studios room in the laundry rooms. The laundry rooms was built by myself and Dave Hadley, my business partner. I think we started about 6 years ago, and it came out of a need for myself to have somewhere to work.
It was called the laundry rooms because it was originally a laundry building as part of I think it was called the Snow Bright Laundry, which featured the fantastic Abbeydale House, which is behind us here. This used to be in the middle of fields, and then the owner fell on hard times, moved out, and they sold all the land, and this became terraced houses. We're right in the centre. Well, we're about 2 miles from the centre of Sheffield, on the western side. These are the old buildings. If we walk down this way, we get down to where the old stables were, and just around the corner, tucked behind what used to be the antique centre, is a building that we discovered just by chance. End up buying and building 5 control rooms and 1 central live area as a kind of a multi-studio complex.
So I'd already approached Dave to see if he fancied co-managing a studio for when I was on tour, so just so we could keep the studio working. So he'd kind of gone, yeah, that sounds like a really good idea. He works as a tour manager and a sound engineer, and he'd been working for Gomez for 10 years. He knew that there was less work coming up. He was looking for a new thing to do. I had wanted to spend less time touring and was looking for something to put a bit of energy into. So we'd kind of decided to work together, and then I decided to buy this building. And at some point, Dave decided to come in with me as a business partner. I'm not sure now, he's not here to ask, but I'm not sure if he regrets it now that we're sort of 6 or 7 years down the line, and we now own a big building with some studios in it.
So let's go around the back. I'll just tell you before we get there that it used to be completely open plan. It was a big camera studio before it was a recording studio. So it had a big white floor with an infinity wall at the end. So it just looked like it went on for ages. It doesn't anymore because we built loads of studios in. So we're just going through and have a look.
So we kind of had this big space. Then I'd read lots of books about how to build a studio, and I'd been on the internet and found loads of conflicting ways of building studios. I'd also wanted to try and get as many control rooms into the studio area as possible, with 1 central live area. The reasoning behind this is because I knew I didn't need much space, and I just really wanted a mix room. But I also knew that the building needed to generate money, and the best way to generate money is to have lots of control rooms sharing a central live area. So we wanted between 4 and 6 control rooms, depending on space.
So first studio we come to, Studio 1, this is our studio. This studio was kind of pretty much built for myself and Dave, my business partner, but pretty much sort of on my general ideas of what I wanted. I wanted an analog mix room where I could mix in a way I'm used to with an analog desk. I've started buying this studio on eBay a good 10 years before we actually even started building it. This has kind of been a culmination of collecting loads and loads of gear over many years. I mean, in the studio here, there's things going back to my Space Echo that I bought in the early 80s. Some of this gear I've had for 30 years. And the studio's kind of grown up organically. Luckily for me, Liam Howlett decided to redo his studio. So a lot of these racks came from Liam, for which I'm eternally grateful. Where we did spend the money was on the architect and designing the room. And you can very much see in all the rooms the shape of the ceilings, the way it's all sloped, and the way there are very few parallel surfaces. And that's all down to working with a really good architect.
Now, I don't know if you've ever tried to, if you kind of get a piece of paper, an A4 piece of paper, and try and draw in funny shaped rooms where the doors all open onto a corridor, and the doors all come in at the right part of the studio and not in the middle of the desk. And it all fits in. And I'd been trying this for ages, and I'd come up with various designs and had not managed it. And within 10 minutes, he'd just drawn this really beautiful thing. I've actually got the plans of what he'd done. And as you can see, I don't know if you can get a close-up on that, it's five weird shaped control rooms and a central live area. And this was sketched out in pencil to start with. And we actually end up changing it slightly. So we actually managed to make the live room slightly bigger than on the original plan. But we pretty much went with this design.
It's very difficult to see the layout. We'll be able to see a bit more of the layout when we go upstairs to what the office is. This is the only bit that was originally left in. All these bits have entirely been built inside the existing structure. It's quite a large space, and it's got a large ramshackle cast iron frame roof above us, which was entirely covered with glass, a lot of which was smashed, and then that's been covered in bitumen, more bitumen, hardboard. So it's basically, we just bought a big shell of a place and we built this inside it. The studio's actually constructed out of 60 Newton blocks. So if you look at the wall, the walls are really thick because the blocks have been laid, instead of being laid upright, they've been laid on their side. So it's about that thick. The doors, as you see, you can't really see the construction here, but I'll show you on one of the other doors where it hasn't been finished off. It's a standard door, but with extra rubber added to it and then another bit of MDF on the inside. So just to make it a double thick door. And then a big lock to pull it tight. And if you listen really quietly, you can actually hear some of the air. As I open the door, you can hear the air escaping because we have to force air into them. They're all interconnected with cables, but otherwise they're all freestanding. If we go down here, we get the corridor, which is just outside the live room. The live room's down here to our right. The live room, this whole section, this corridor and the live room is all built floating and unattached from the rest of the building. As you can see here, the concrete doesn't go right up to this next door's wall. There's actually rubber just down there. And if we go right down to here, you can't really tell, but the whole of this wall is sat on something called Tecoflex, which is it's a heavy density rubber, which means that this is all floating on rubber. We'd love to have floated all the rooms. The control rooms aren't, but the live room is. But it's £50 a linear metre, and we've used quite a lot of it. It cost a couple of grand just to build this wall on rubber. As we go through another one of the thick doors, and we come into the live room. Here's the live room. It's a funny old shape. It's deliberate. All the rooms have been made with as few parallel walls as possible. This one, I don't think it's got any parallel surfaces. The ceiling is obviously sloped, as you can see. The walls are all at different angles, which means that when you clap, it's still quite lively, but there's no flutter echoes because the sound is bouncing from here to there to there to there to back again, from down there to up here. We've got a certain amount of treatment. We've got these baffles in and above. But I'm quite pleased with the sound in here. We've got some reasonable drum sounds in this room. It's not as big as we want. I'd love a room that was four times bigger than this. But we have to face the fact that you buy a building for a certain size. The bigger the building, the more expensive it costs. We couldn't afford a bigger building, so we had to fill it with as many money-generating things as we could. And the live area just doesn't generate that much money. So it's shared between all the different rooms. These wall boxes, they feed through. So that's Studio 1, Studio 2, over here, Studio 3, Studio 4, Studio 5. The floor is floating, so it's concrete floor. This has got a real wood floor, which is not touching the side. So underneath the end here, the floor doesn't touch the walls, so that you get very little noise from outside this room to the studios, which is the most important thing, because you've got five control rooms, we can't have people that are making noise in here disturbing what's going on in one of the other studios. You can get a drum kit, as you see, in here quite comfortably. And we've got a tie lines running to a couple of little booths, which I'll show you in a minute, running in the back. So we can put the guitar amps and the bass amp into the little booths. We can run lines through. We've got some radio boxes so that we can send the guitar. We can plug it through the patch bay and it'll come out at the same level in the guitar booth, which means you can get the same sound as you'd normally expect just by plugging the guitar straight in. And you can get three or four musicians in here quite comfortably. We can change the acoustics slightly just by doing things like pulling the curtain across. We tend to do that if we're doing vocals. But this is the live room, the main live room. And once again, it's shared by all the five studios. So any studio is all tied in to this one room. It also means that we can tie studios together through the live room. So we can run a signal from my studio to Martin's studio to Dave's studio quite easily just through the live room. So this is it, the live room. Let's go and see what's down the corridor. There's another three studios down here. There's two at that end. So Jancy, Dave and Steve's studio in here. Steve Nichols' studio here. And at the moment, this one is, we're just waiting for someone to move out and to get a new tenant into this one. So we'll have a room to rent soon. You can kind of see the way that there's gaps in between them. You can also see that all the cables run through the wall, so it's all sealed off. Where we've had to run, this is running the tie lines, and that all disappears up and then goes through the roof and then into the other studios. When we do guitars, we converted this storeroom into a little place to actually do guitars from. So in here, there's just a tiny little guitar booth, which you can get big enough to get a guitar combo in. And then next door, I think there's actually a guitar amp in this one. Yeah, just big enough to get a 4x12 in and a cab. And obviously there's tie lines in the corner there to run through. So we can put the guitars in here, have them as loud as we need. It's all been done out with heavy foam, so they're quite dead, and the sound doesn't leak too much to the other studios. So we can actually get it quite loud. So you can run your guitar up to a proper volume without having to worry about it spilling across. And the heart of any studio. This is probably the single most important area. We have the kettle, the coffee machine, and probably more important in some ways, the microwave fridge, which also, remarkably, features beer. And just to show the honesty of people, look, had two of your beers, sorry, £2 below to cover costs. Now, this is the kind of tenants we want, good, honest tenants. This is one of the few bits that was originally left in the studio, and it's kind of an office for myself and Dave and a work area. So this is it. This is the studio, and as you look out the window, if you can do that, you'll see our various collection thing, and you can see kind of the top of the studios and how it goes back. It's difficult to tell, but... And once upon a time, this was all, it was all a big empty space out there until we built our various rooms. And now we'll go around and look at all the individual rooms and talk to the various people who rent the studios, the tenants, and the people who work and earn their money from music in the laundry rooms.
So when we were approaching various people to move in, various names came up. I mean, to be honest, we didn't advertise the rooms. We did it by word of mouth. And partially because we wanted to vet to a certain extent the people were coming in, because we needed, it was very important. If you've got five studios all in one building, it's important that they're not competing with each other. So we didn't want five engineers who just want to work doing demos for bands, because that way you'd have five people all wanting to use the live room as much as possible. We want to try and get a mix of clientele, really. So it was great because Martin was doing lots and lots of film music at the time, was looking for somewhere new to work. And so we met him. He was obviously, it's a very niche market, really, isn't it, your market?
It was primarily just music for TV, and now it's branched out into bands and artists as well.
And Steve was doing sort of very much his dance music, well, both the Steves, Steve Nichol and Steve and Dave in Studio One, they were doing their kind of very much dance-oriented stuff. Steve Nichol was doing his kind of retro pop thing. So we kind of tried to get a broad mix of things. The thing about this is that you never know what you're going to be doing, and you've got to keep moving and reacting to things and changing your business plan.
Exactly, that's the key to being in music. It's like being dynamic. Okay, this is happening now. There's a requirement for that. And you just have to change course, don't you? But you have to stay really dynamic to it. If you plough ahead with some business plan you had when a particular industry was working, you'll get left behind as something takes over.
Music business has changed. It's constantly changing. And, you know, you've had to adapt much more.
Yeah, for sure.
Probably.
Yeah, I mean, adverts cut back their budgets a little bit. And people started self-releasing, which is a good position for our studio, because essentially, like, the music industry is in London. So if you're wanting to work on records for the industry, they're tending to use London studios. But there are lots of artists self-releasing who are making records, and there are many in Sheffield and the surrounding areas. So we kind of fill that niche. We're good for artists who want to self-release or smaller labels. And we're not necessarily a demo studio. That's not really our area, but we do like to turn out records for people. We've managed to sort of get more into that market over time.
And the way that works is that you're not all stamping on each other's toes all the time, because you're not all competing for the same work. But you also can help each other. And we always try to, I mean, I don't know how successful we are, but we've always tried to build up a cooperative vibe.
Hi, I'm Dave. You're here at InPhase Studios, based at the Laundry Rooms in Sheffield. We've been here for about 4 years now. It's a dance music studio. We make predominantly trance music, but in the past we've made for various other producers, different styles, dubstep, drum and bass, house music.
What difference does it make having a space like this?
I think the acoustics are always playing an important part to me. So I always find that to get used to your sort of setup, it's easier when you've got a nicely treated room. Obviously from having a history of mixing in various different bedrooms, then when you put you think you've made the next great club hit, and then you put it in a room like this and
yeah, I mean,
see what you've missed.
I've found it a lot more consistent, I know what the room's sounding like, and we did try and make them as flat sounding as possible for the space we've got. Everyone's kind of a bit different, and I like this room, I must admit. It's nice and wide and it's got a lot of space. It's probably one of the largest rooms we've got.
Yeah.
Is it worth getting a place like this? I mean, it's not an unreasonable amount of money. I mean, it must be quite a drain on you and Steve each month.
It's well worth it. It's it depends what you want to do, really. I mean, if you wanted to make a career out of it, it's probably, I mean, everyone's got to start somewhere. I think the vast majority will start in their bedroom with the basics, your basic monitor setup, and I think it's just a case of just building, because I mean we haven't built this overnight. It's taken sort of years and a lot of sort of graft to and chipping in just to get all the stuff that we've got. So it's just a steady progression, I think, from bedroom to professional.
The important thing about being in a place like this is that you get to work in your own room all the time, but you also get to be around other people and working in a close proximity to people who are very interested in the things that you do, and you can bounce ideas off of, and that you can go, oh, I'm can't do this, do you know how to do this, have you got any ideas of what I can do with this? And we go and play each other's stuff all the time, and I feed off Martin all the time, mainly because he knows how the logic shortcuts and things like that, and I can just go, I don't know how to do this, and there's a lot of that kind of thing. So where Martin goes, like, I want to buy some really stupid old vintage gear, what should I buy, have you got anything I can borrow? And it's kind of a lot of that, it's really important. I mean, it's helped me a lot.
Yeah, it's helped me massively. If I'm like talking about dance music or synths, you know, I know who to talk to. Steve Nichols is all over that stuff.
Yeah.
You know, I can say, what's this synth on this record? And he's probably knowing it. And if he needs to record guitars, he can come in and borrow some pedals. And
Now, Steve, even though you're Studio 2, you were the first person I managed to con into joining us on this enterprise.
And then they all followed me.
Like a
flock
fish.
Of lambs.
Yeah. And I believe I actually technically probably lied to you, and that I did actually, the main selling point was that it was going to be heated, and we only actually got the heating in a little while ago.
It was a cold winter.
It's been many cold winters.
Many a cold winter.
But not as cold as your last studio.
No, that was the coldest. I used to work in there in boxer shorts in the summer and in like 3 onesies in the winter. It was that kind
of
place.
Has this been an improvement?
Not at first. Yeah. No, it's made a massive difference, really, like having an environment like this where you don't have to sweat to death or freeze to death.
Because this is pretty much this is your baby kind of thing.
Yeah, definitely.
And, I mean, what does it mean to have, like, a studio like this that you can just come to work in all the time?
Well, you can't really knock it. I mean, you could have... You don't really want to be... I don't like... traveling from one studio to the next when it comes to trying to do your own music. It's fine when you're working for other people because you go to where the work is, but you need your own space where you know when you come in everything is set up how you want it, and it's all your own kit and you know it inside out, and so it's like a workflow thing, really. You couldn't do it any other way.
How has it changed though? I mean, because now you've worked in other studios, do you go in other studios and go, this is just brilliant?
When I'm not here, like a couple of days a week, I've got a friend who comes in and uses it, and so some of the kit that's in here, like a few bits and pieces, like that synthesizer and that synthesizer, belong to someone else and they've brought in, and we kind of like integrated kit, and he gets a lot out of using all of my kit and I get the benefit of using what he's brought in. So it's a symbiotic.
Yeah, I mean, it's always been important, you know, as a building, we've always tried to encourage people to work with each other, which is why I know there's a couple of bits and pieces of mine, and I'm sure we're going to borrow. We've all been playing with the Eventide Harmony this week. Jack was in here yesterday.
He loves it.
Going through every single preset, I think.
He loves it.
After a while, it sort of got to the point where I sort of built up a few of the things that I wanted to buy myself. And I sort of approached Steve and said, is it something that you think you'd be interested in doing, like a timeshare type thing? Yeah. And it works so well because we're always buying something, always changing something. So you come in and be like, oh, there's a new piece of... So there's constantly a bit of excitement there. I mean, it's a massive difference. Particularly for the first few months, and still now, actually, I'm really grateful to have access to this space, to be perfectly honest. So it's just great that everyone seems to get on really well.
Because people work in their own rooms, you can tend to get like a cabin fever sort of attitude. Then you walk out the room and then you can talk about what you're doing with other people who understand.
You need to be able to bounce off people and to step out of your reality into someone else's. And I think it's really important.
Well, music's always better as a team activity, isn't it? As much as we can all do music on our own, it's so much more fun to do it with other people.
Everyone here loves music. We do this because we love music. You don't do this because of the money. If you want to earn money, don't open a studio. Don't own a studio, because it's not a great money earner, believe me. No. I mean, this scrapes by, but it's given us the chance to do lots of other things. It's a springboard as much as anything else.
Yeah, I think in music you're a lifer or you're a dabbler.
Yeah.
And like the people here are all lifers, you know, we're just...
condemned.
We're going to crack on regardless.
I only did my first proper live session in the studio about a year ago. First project where I'd seen from beginning to end, where I'd recorded in my studio, because I was too busy either building the studios or working as a live engineer. Martin's done albums and singles and loads of stuff, and has done loads more recording in this place than I have. Dave, business partner's done loads more than I have. Everyone's done loads more than I have, but it's, you know, it's just the way things have worked.
Well, real life's what happens when you're making other plans, isn't it?
Yeah.
And this is great for you when you're ready to use it. But at the moment, you know, obviously...
In my retirement.
When you've got big clients queuing up to employ you.
I didn't expect the last Prodigy tour to last 5 years, pretty much. So it was just one of those things.
Yeah. It's a terrible situation, isn't it, being in demand?